Kitty's on her way in, and Paul's online.
Is Paul online? Okay. Okay. Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to our June 3rd Finance and Administration Committee meeting. Our minutes will obviously be taken care of at briefing, so we will move into our discussion items here. First up is a resolution adopting 24-25 federal legislative agenda. Eric Paulson.
Good morning, Mr. Chair.
Good morning.
Council President, Council Member, not plural yet.
That's right.
I am here to talk for a few minutes about federal agenda development, but I have a couple comments first about congressionally directed spending and some news. So wanted you to know that this has been a real focal point of our federal legislative program over the past couple years, but it's a new opportunity for the city because earmarks, as they're affectionately known, were really the mainstay of congressional budgeting for decades, and plagued by some fraud, accusations of pork barrel politics. They were completely suspended in 2011, and after a 10-year moratorium were reintroduced in 2021, but with much stricter controls, a very elaborate process, highly competitive. Just to give you an example, this year when Spokane submitted our CDS request, Senator Murray's office received over 550 requests on top of ours. Typically 10 to 20 are funded. It's much like the state's capital budget. The dollar amounts tend to be pretty similar, and we've had a lot of success in this space. So wanted to highlight a few things that are before you on the screen. You're going to be seeing the SMART acronym more often as time goes on, and this is a component of the street medicine approach that the city is taking to deal with, particularly with downtown homelessness and the need for immediate health care not provided by emergency rooms. It's we've talked a lot about this at committee. It's really a multidisciplinary approach with teams of behavioral health experts, fire and police, case managers, just to bring some urgent care to people who are experiencing homelessness. We requested $2 million in our CDS this year, and just got news over the weekend that Senator Murray has put this forward as one of her priority items. Also, Senator Cantwell has done the same, but for a slightly smaller amount. So we're in the game. That's pretty big news and something to be excited about. This really builds on the state money that the city received for street medicine this past session. I believe it was a $1 million pilot project. So we're starting to amass some really significant resources to move forward with the SMART initiative. So that's pretty exciting. Some of the other victories we've had just since this was introduced a couple years ago are on your screen there. Notably, District 1 received the highest earmark to date since they were reintroduced. So I wanted to call that out for you, Mr. Chair.
We'll take it.
And all of our representatives and senators have been incredibly helpful at this. Congresswoman McMorris-Rogers only single-handedly worked on the Wellesley item. The others have all had support of Senator Murray and Cantwell, as well as McMorris-Rogers. So we have a great team at our federal level, just like our state level. Makes life easier for all of us. A couple words about the federal agenda update before you. So it's been a few years since we've done an update, and it's definitely overdue. Part of the reason we haven't had a robust list every year like we do our state agendas, frankly, it just takes a long, long time to get funding requests through the process. Legislation passes more slowly. There hasn't been sort of the urgent need to update it every 6 months like we do with our state agenda. And our federal agenda has been really focused on ARPA and getting through the pandemic. And as we round that corner and come back into a new era, kind of back to normal, if that's possible in federal politics anytime soon, these are some of the things that the council, the administration, especially department heads, outside stakeholders that the city works with frequently have identified as priorities, high profile issues that we want to keep a close watch on. Not all of them have immediate action items, but we're often asked by our lobbyists, by congressional staffers, you know, what does the city care about? What are the things that are most important to you? So your legislative team has tried to capture most of those items. Of course, this can be changed with your regular committee process. It often is. But I wanted to just give a quick shout out, since I have a few extra minutes here, I'm not at the end of your agenda, for the people on our LEDGE team who have done the bulk of this work. And the three council members currently on LEDGE team are Council Member Bingle, Council Member Dillon, and Council Member Zappone, Policy Advisor Wright, Policy Advisor McDaniel, all of our initiative managers, Nicolette Ockletree, Abigail Martin, Alex Gibalisco, many administration staff, our regulars, come to these meetings, Marlene Feist, Steve McDonald, Catherine Miller, and then as specific issues come up where we need insights from Spencer Gardner, he's often there, Chris Avert from Waste to Energy, so it's just, it really speaks to the camaraderie and the interest in both sides of City Hall coming together to develop these agendas. And I don't want to go line by line through all of them. Again, they don't all have action items, but a couple notes. Maybe you could go back up just a little bit. Thank you, Jacoby. I also forgot our lobbyists. Of course, they're first and foremost big part of our, they really inform our legislative agenda process at both the state and federal level. So Brian Christensen is our federal guy, and he'll be here later today to meet on waste energy initiatives. So if you haven't had a chance to meet him yet, definitely I will help make that happen. Question?
Well, you mentioned waste energy, and that just leads me to something. I'm just wondering, in terms of how these kind of categories were drafted, the language, I'm just kind of wondering what that process was. Was it the LEDGE committee or the administration kind of giving some input, or how did that sort of come together?
Well, so, you know, organizing such a big laundry list of issues is kind of challenging. We could have had 50 categories.
Well, so I just mean from the categories we have, the descriptions of them. And for example, the waste to energy, I'm just curious. The way it's written, it just sounds like we're running circles around an edge, and we're not making the point. And I think the point is we want the waste energy plan exempted from overburdensome ecological regulations, right? I mean, that's essentially what we're trying to do. This doesn't sound like we're actually trying to do that. It sounds like we're trying to change the technology or do something different. And so anyway, I'm just wondering, what does it actually mean?
Well, that particular item, I think, you know, there are some generalities in the verbiage here, in part because issues change, technology changes. Something that's true for us today might not be true tomorrow. So, you know, when the language was initially developed, there was an intention to kind of focus on the big picture, make some kind of broader statements, not invite a lot of controversy, if possible, and just to flag issues that are important for the city. I think everybody would be open to language changes.
And by all means, if there's more questions, my only comment on this would be, I mean, this is a pretty big deal for us, right? The waste energy plant goes down or has to be mitigated significantly. That's a pretty substantial issue for us. And so I just think we have to be direct on stuff like that and say, this is what we're trying to accomplish, and not just kind of, you know, run around the edges.
Sure,
a little bit,
yeah, I appreciate that input.
That's my thought.
And we'll be better informed at the end of today. We're meeting to talk about the life cycle analysis work that was done on waste to energy previously and to start discussing political strategy for state level and federal level. So I think as that issue moves forward, we'll have, you know, we'll know more, we'll have more direction from you and council. I mean, the same could be said for PFAS too. Like, a lot of questions have come up about that, a lot of comments, a lot of ideas about how to handle that strategically, and we don't know exactly yet how it's going to shake out and how other cities are going to show up in that debate.
Well, and I know Council President's got something, but, you know, the county's working on a plan that could be a part of that. It could be something completely different. I do have questions around what the exemption for utilities means for us. I'm not entirely sure what that means, but go ahead.
So I was just going to comment, Eric, on the verbiage of this. Did not the waste energy folks have input on how this was written, the description of this language? So I think I want to get to who actually wrote the language or the input in the language itself.
Yeah,
I know some come from our lobbyists, but locally we had input on how this was described.
Yeah, I think that particular item was, the language was either developed by our friends in utilities or it was vetted by them. Nothing here is sort of, you know, Eric Polson's idea of what the issue is and nobody else's. So everybody's had eyeballs on it. And again, I think there's, you know, room to make verbiage changes if the committee doesn't feel stuff is strong enough. So
yeah, and Marlene and team, they're regularly in these meetings with us. This isn't something that they haven't seen.
Yeah. Right. So.
And just on that PFAS, that language is as wide a net as we can cast for whatever may come down the pike to the federal government.
Right. So. Yeah, so some of the items are very specific. Others are a little wider. I mean, again, the verbiage probably isn't as important as just capturing what some of the priorities are. A lot of the reason for the agendas is to inform the lobbyists, to give them a sense of what should they be prioritizing their time on. So if we didn't get the words exactly right, we can improve that.
Well, and these issues, again, they evolve as time goes on, you know. And so for us, it's here's a general idea, and then as we're getting more information back, then we can adjust and move our language with it to make sure that we're as successful as possible. So a little bit more generic up front, but it does get more specific as we find out what funding sources are available, what's their support for in our state and federal legislatures. And so we do adjust these as we go.
Right.
So
and the team go ahead.
I was gonna say the issues that are up there are ones that started at the local, went to the state level, and now have advanced to the federal, because these we have been addressing for a while at our state level. So
yeah. There's a lot of nexus between federal and state issues. Councilmember.
And just so I have a question for you. I'm hearing from a lot of folks that we might there might be a lot of money left at the federal level for particular infrastructure projects. Is that true?
I can't comment specifically.
Okay.
I mean, but I hear the same rumblings as you do.
Yep.
And of course, the Latah Bridge rehab project is a massive request. It falls far outside what the CDS process will be able to help us with. So that was one of the items I wanted to draw to your attention. It's not typical for us to have such a large request that we're pursuing, and it will take an all hands and all programs on deck approach, similar to what the Valley's done with their Bridging the Valley initiatives. So I definitely see that as a big fight headed our way, a fight to get those resources, and something the administration has identified as their number one infrastructure project. Mm-hmm. So.
Eric, where do you see kind of the priorities being? And not necessarily priorities because of what council wants or the administration wants, but in terms of where sort of the power centers are of Murray, Cantwell, Kathy for now, and then, you know, when the new person's coming in, whoever that might be. What does that look like?
Well, I guess I can just comment generally that we develop these agendas with input from their offices and their staff heads locally and in Washington. So you know, it's a very reciprocal relationship where they want to know what our priorities are, and they go above and beyond to help the city. Some of these things are particular priorities of the congressional delegation themselves. I'm trying to think of an example here. Fairchild Air Force Base, broadband, you know, these are things that our delegation has really led on, and we're trying to partner with them and vice versa. So, okay.
One last quick comment. I'm glad that the administration, particularly on Laytaw, that that's a focus of theirs. I'm encouraged to hear that, and I would encourage them to keep going. From that infrastructure bill, I hear there's a fair amount of money left, and I would just encourage all of us to do everything we can to get that money, because there are serious projects that we need help on that we'll never be able to fund ourselves. And so thank you, thank the administration, thank everybody working on this, because it's going to take all of us to get that money, and we got to push pretty hard for it. So
thank you.
One last from me is just I would love to just see some more specific language on the Fairchild that's actually calling for more housing on base. And this talks more just about providing housing generally to support military spouses. And to me, that's sort of insinuating off-base housing. And I think we should be making a huge, substantial push for more on-base housing.
So. Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that reminder. We had a good conversation about this with our federal lobbyist and yourself. And that maybe isn't perfectly captured here. But I know that's the intent.
Perfect. So. Okay. All right. Thanks, Eric. Appreciate it.
You're welcome.
All right. Moving on. Jacoby, you want to queue up the next one?
Yep. The next item on your agenda is a resolution that would appoint a candidate to fill the role of the council's budget director. A couple years back, council decided it was a priority of theirs to staff a position in the council office that would assist in analyzing budgets, helping understand fiscal impacts of legislation coming both out of the council office and from the administration, and generally assist with keeping eyes on the annual budget throughout the year. So this position we posted a couple months ago, and the position closed, and we got some really good candidates, had a first round of interviews with the finance and administration work group team, and now are teed up for second round interviews in a couple of weeks with all council members and staff and smaller groups. And I anticipate the council president and the finance chair will work together to bring forward a candidate whose name would be filled in this resolution. Per our SMC, these positions are hired via resolution with an affirmative vote of four. So this will be before you likely at the end of June, if all goes well.
Okay. Very good. Any questions? Nope. All right. Well, we're looking forward to having our budget director in place. That is, as Jacoby said, definitely a very high priority, especially when much of our work depends on us being able to deal with the budgeting issues. Okay, moving on to number three, ordinance updates on camping enforcement. So I've put this, it's in the packet, and it really is kind of a modest change to our existing camping law. What it does is twofold. First, it changes. So right now, the rule is for enforcement around congregate shelters is that it's three blocks around any congregate shelter. But congregate shelter is kind of a narrow term. And as we're hearing a lot of conversations around changing the scope of different things, moving different providers into areas that would not be encapsulated under this existing law necessarily, and providers that do attract, you know, high impact campers and things like that. And so what this does is instead of saying that it's three blocks around any congregate shelter, it expands the definition to comprehensive support services. And then it defines comprehensive support services here it is. Comprehensive support services means services encompassing addiction recovery services, resource distribution centers, congregate shelters, transitional or non-permanent housing. Such services include, but are not limited to, behavioral health services providers as defined in RCW. So that's the first. And then it also, just to make it more consistent with the law that was approved by the voters, instead of three blocks, it's 1,000 feet, which is consistent. And then the last change is our existing camping ordinance requires, or I should say limits, enforcement to only the viaducts that are downtown, essentially, in the downtown core. And as I have seen a significant expansion of camping activities in the other viaducts, especially, and this is, I think, a compliment as to the effectiveness of our enforcement in these viaducts downtown, I think it becomes really important that we eliminate that restriction and allow for the enforcement in those other viaducts. And so that would include, you know, Napa, Helena, places like that, where we do see these issues cropping up. So that is the crux of it. There, like I said, it's a very, I think, modest tweak, in my opinion, but one that's necessary, especially with some of the moving pieces that we're seeing right now in the homelessness world. Council President.
So, hello. Good morning, everybody. Councilmember Cathcart,
yes.
I would just like to give the administration the opportunity
sure.
to present the existing rule to council and a review of how that's being implemented. I understand we want to bring on additional tools, but I think until we know really what's being effective and how that's being implemented and the fiscal impact what this would be before we proceed with something else additional.
Sure.
And I know they could speak to that, but I think that's a reasonable request to have them come to us and give us an update.
Yeah, and 1 second, I'll just say, and happy to do that, and if they want to come down now, that's perfectly fine. As far as fiscal impact goes, I mean, again, this is a tool, and the tool is used as it's enabled, as our officers and code enforcement and behavioral health folks are enabled to use it, that's when it's used. And so I don't think that there is a additional cost per se, although we can happily have finance take a look and work up what that cost would be.
Yeah, no, I would love to have the administration come down and share with us. I think, you know, there's a number of questions surrounding the enforcement of Prop 1 and other things. And so if administration wanted to come and present, I mean, I think it'd be informative for all of us to help understand, you know, if there are reasons why certain things are being enforced or why they're not being enforced and what that what those reasons are. So, yeah, happy to hear from them.
And I as well. My concern is with Prop 1, expectations where we would be responding immediately to calls, and they just go in the queue. So with this passage of this additional tool, neighborhoods would be expecting immediate response or the issues to be dealt with. And so really, I don't want to elevate that to where we can't deliver.
Okay.
Councilmember Dillon has his hand
up. Councilmember Dillon.
Yeah, thank you so much. Sorry, I got a call in this morning, but I am curious just about, you know, kind of the legal analysis too about how this, you know, connects with the Supreme Court cases that are moving, where we can expect a ruling here before the end of the month, and you know that's been kind of the lingering question too with Prop 1. So I guess did that kind of analysis, you know, come into play here with drafting this proposal?
No, this has not gone before legal yet, although we have had ad nauseum amounts of legal input into sort of this issue in the past, predating yourself, Councilmember Dillon. But I'm sure a lot of that is still, that work product is still available, as well as new. I'm sure we can get a new review of this specifically. I will just say, and this is coming from somebody who is not a lawyer, that given the fact that I think it's on the record effectively that we are not actively enforcing Prop 1, there has not been a substantial expansion of enforcement areas. And so this would be extremely minor in relation to our existing code. And then I think once the courts give us an opinion on the Oregon case,
Grants Pass,
once they give us some feedback on the Grants Pass case, then I think we'll know in the broader context what the impacts are of this. But go ahead.
Well, and is as regularly stated to folks like myself, we can always change it, right? And so I hear that pretty regularly, and so we can do what we believe to be the right thing now, and then if the Supreme Court rules something and it changes the way that we can enforce our own ordinances, then we will do the right thing and fall into line with whatever ruling comes down. But we shouldn't allow those things in the future, because I hear this regularly. Well, we don't know what's going to happen here. We don't know what's going to happen here. Well, in the interim, let's do the right thing right now. And that's why I think this is a good idea. And again, it is not a significant expansion. Prop 1 far outweighs, when you're looking at the expansion areas and the areas being enforced. This is a pretty small a pretty minor expansion of it. And so I don't think there was anything, even with the decision in the grants pass, I don't think there's any way that this has an effect on it.
Yeah. And so we, but I will happily send it off to legal today and get that ball rolling. And then we can, you know, schedule time at a either a study session or at the next finance committee on the 24th and go through it then.
So. Councilmember Dillon has his hand up again.
Yeah.
Yeah, one more question, and thank you for that. I guess, you know, I did a fire alarm on Friday, and I mean, honestly, it was pretty dismaying at the number of calls, I think, around brush fires and, you know, the as we saw last summer around the West Hills, and I think the heightened concern, and, you know, had a constituent reach out about some encampments where, you know, there were fires kind of starting on the bluff above Inland Empire Way. And I think it's such obviously, we all know this, you know this, it's such a multi-layered, multifaceted issue. You know, what I think can be done specifically to some of those encampments in the wildland urban, you know, interface where there is such a significant risk of fire, because, you know, it's hard for code enforcement to get to, it's hard for SPD to get to. That presents a real challenge that I think we gotta have some further discussion about.
Yeah.
More a comment, less of a question, I guess. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, thank you, Councilmember Dillon. I couldn't agree more, and I'll make one more comment here, but Councilmember Dillon has a comment.
Who?
Councilmember Bingle, excuse me.
Yeah, no, and if they're within, I believe, 100 feet of the river, that is a part of our current sit-and-lie anti-camping ordinance right now, so that can happen. Because I went to Mission Park yesterday for an NA volleyball game for recovering addicts, and there are encampments in between the railroad tracks at Mission Park and the river right now. And the trouble is that we have children obviously playing in this park. We have people who are recovering addicts trying to do it. And then there's drug paraphernalia littered throughout this park. There's drug deals constantly happening. And so in this space where it's within 100 feet of the park, and I could be a little wrong and that might be 50, but it's somewhere in that 50 to 100 feet of a river. It is something that we can already enforce.
Well, and just one last thing, and then we can move on to the next. There is some really, I think, fascinating new technology that's evolving when it comes to drones and things like that. The city of Chicago has now adopted these drones that can fly, not autonomously, they are controlled by a person, but they can go out of sight 18 miles. And what I had considered quite a bit last year was an ordinance, and then we went a different direction on some things, and I'm still interested in this, but an ordinance that would sort of push us in that direction of using drones to fly over the urban wildland urban interface to look for heat signatures, to look for evidence of camping, things like that, not for per se for enforcement of camping itself, but because of the fire risk and making sure that we are proactively preventing those fires from occurring in those areas where we have no eyes, and frankly, it's extremely resource intensive and time intensive to go in and just look to see if there's something happening. So,
Councilmember Cathcart, I can't remember when, but I know that I work with Councilmember Kinnear that we did do a drone ordinance specifically around Channel 5. I know fire has one, so maybe pull it up and see how we can enhance that to maybe do what you're trying to achieve.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great idea. Mm-hmm. We'll take a look. One more.
And at the Police Foundation's breakfast, I think the police just said that they just purchased one, too. That was pretty high tech.
That one's pretty, yeah. That was pretty interesting. Okay, next up, Matt Boston, mid-year budget variance SBO.
Yeah, thank you, Council. I appreciate it. Jacoby, perfect. Thank you. So just talking really quickly about the SBO process, what we're going to be doing. Generally, we would have the SBO presented as part of the May Finance Committee, of which is today. But since we have a little bit of an extended timeline because the canceled meetings, as well as the budget hearing that's happening this coming, Thursday the 13th, We've decided to enhance that conversation to be the full hour and a half so that we're going to talk about the SBO, the different line items that we're talking about, as well as kind of have the department heads there to answer some of the questions. But just to give you a quick overview of what we're talking about.
Matt, is there a different black clicker down there?
Yep.
Thank it's you. The down arrow
on
that.
This clicker is my demise. All right, so just really quick agenda, timeline overview, discussion of the 2023 results, basis of our future projections, review of the SMC 0714-030C2 and 3, and then projected 2024 mid-year budget impact. So, again, just reviewing the timeline overview, June 3rd being today is our strategy really quick discussion. June 13th will be our monthly budget discussion with department heads and council regarding the five-year projection, as well as substantial type code differences and substantial changes to the general fund budget needed to be made. We'll talk a little bit about what type code differences are, because that's kind of a nuance that I want to make sure that everybody is aware of. June 13th to July 8th is going to be that time to talk to council members as well as administration to get a little bit more insight onto what those changes are and if council has any suggestions on the flip side. And then July 8th is ultimately the vote. 2023 results and reserve balance. Just to give you a quick high-level overview, the accounting department did deliver the financial reports to the state auditor's office on May 29th, so just last week. Kudos to Michelle Murray and her team for working diligently on getting that. It is always a heavy lift, and we always do really, really great with the SAO, so fingers crossed that we continue to have that same reputation. The field work begins in stages, and city will generally hear back in August for responses and updated needs. So that's just to say that we don't have a finalized financial report until they've combed through the books and see if we need to make any changes. Highlights, approximately $3 million was added in the general fund reserves in 2023. So that's great news. So that means we ended up with a surplus at the end of 2023, landing us to about approximately $10 million in unallocated reserve balance. That's obviously up from the $7 million that we previously had. Supplies and other services fell pretty well under budget, and that is the other services are our contractual services, supplies obviously being self-explanatory. And then you'll remember that we did have that large mid-year police overtime budget, and they did fall just short of that, so that added to that reserve balance being added back. There was a question on kind of what the from the Finance Executive Committee, what the basis of our projections are going to be as we're looking at our five-year horizon, as we're looking at the remainder of 2024. And the Budget Department, as well as myself, as I've worked with many of you, the Budget Department and myself use a myriad of different tools and resources that are out there. For the revenue pieces, we use property tax, we use the county calculations. That's pretty self-explanatory, and we generally hit the nose right on the head. The only variance there is the new construction that gets thrown around. Interfund utility tax, that's a calculation based on public works revenue projections. We get that from Marlene and their team. We work pretty much hand in hand during the projections of looking at what the historical actuals are, kind of the blips in seasonality, et cetera. Private utility tax, we pull that right off of the Vista's website because they announce their rate changes and we tax them based on their current revenue plus the rate changes. And then sales tax we get from Dr. Patrick Jones and the economic reports that utilize data from the state and historical analysis. Just a note, I know that Dr. Jones was scheduled to talk to you all after Q1, but had to cancel that. One thing that I just want to note is that 2024 is likely to be weak in the first half, and that's exactly what we're seeing with our sales tax numbers. Right now, I believe we're showing at overall sales tax at about 0.97% above prior year for March numbers, but we're about 2.5%. So as you remember, the council actually amended the previous administration's projections to a more conservative approach. Kudos for you all for making that decision, because it seems like that was the right move. The March 2024 sales tax is getting hit really, really hard. 2023 to 2024 is well below But the thing that did recover us in March of 2024 was the accommodation and food service sales tax that was up about 20%. So that led us to that 1%, but year to date, about 2.5%. Again, we're expecting that to pick up in the second half. And then return to normal at about 3% year over year. And again, that's the number that you all have heard many, many times over is our revenue growth. Yes.
What are the indicators that you're looking at that's giving you the confidence that it's going to go back to normal?
So it generally has to do with the median income, and that's the metric that lands it pretty closely aligned, as all of the numbers that we can see from Dr. Jones's reports. I think it was 5.9% year over year in 2023, and I think he's projecting 5.4 and 5.4 for 25 and 26. So that's getting us back to that that roughly 3% revenue growth. Obviously, a downward trend in the beginning of 2024, of which we were expecting based on just kind of the uncertainty that was out there. But that's kind of where we're at right now on just the projection. But again, keeping our finger on the pulse as much as possible is highly critical when we're talking about sales tax projections. The budget office is currently working through all of those projections for a five-year horizon to try to have something very detailed for you for that June 13th meeting. We are obviously wanting to be as adamant of having qualified and accurate projections as we can versus what you've previously seen, which was that modest, pessimistic, optimistic sort of projections. We're really going to try to tighten the screws to get you one projection of this is what we're seeing based on all of these variables that are out here. Again, so really quick, SMC 0714030 was instituted last year. So last year was the first year that the mid-year SBO was done. As you all remember, last year was a $9 million additional expense for police overtime. That was that red blinking screen that we were all talking about of, hey, this is a problem. We don't want to be dealing with this in Q4. That came off the heels of 21 and 2022, where there was Q4 very large SBOs. That was just identifying and actually showing the spotlight on the structural gap year over year that was just growing at an exponential rate. So the code itself is designed to find substantial variances between budget and actual projections at a summary type code level. Summary type code is what we use as a kind of an accounting term that grabs a bunch of different very detailed accounts and wraps them all together. So 5,100 is all of the wage accounts. 5,200 is all of the benefits. 5,300 is all supplies. 5,400 is all of contracts, and so on and so on. We have the same thing going on for revenue. So as we're looking at that, that is the type code that SMC actually identifies to say this is what we have to identify and highlight, because again it was those wage overtime expenditures that were alarming the council in years past. So with that said, what we're seeing is not a large variance between any of those accounts that are identifying kind of that red blinking screen. But there are revenue enhancements / budget efficiencies that we can be making. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, well, I was just going to say, I mean, I think at the time when we passed that, part of the idea was that, the administration needs to be proactive in bringing to council, you know, those variations of what, plus or minus $250,000, right, in each department.
Yep.
Under this type code. But the intent, though, was to create a situation where we could, in a wholesale way, if necessary, you know, change our budget to address whatever the future.
Absolutely.
You know, so we're not restricted in any way. I just want to make sure that's clear.
That yeah.
There's a lot of, we have a lot of flexibility to
change
our budget.
Yeah. And you know what, the mayor actually brought up a really great idea this morning to talk about, you know, why are we not looking at this at a program level? Why are we looking at it at the type code level? And that's really a great question, right? As we're developing programs and we're seeing what is over budget, under budget in programs, that gives us a better detailed narrative of how we're accomplishing our goals set forth in the priorities of the budget. So something that we could probably explore in future years. But again, this is just, this was meant to kind of stop the bleed that we are seeing in 21, 22, 23, and even going into 2024. So the code requires any substantial differences that need corrections will be addressed in a special budget ordinance to correct the budget projections. Now, some of the changes that can be made, plus or minus, don't necessarily need to go to a budget ordinance. They can be done as a budget transfer that doesn't have to have council approval. But we do want to highlight some of those things that are going to be happening, and we will be talking about those on the June 13th meeting. And again, you will be voting on that on July 8th. And just to wrap it up, I mean, I just wanted to end it really with some great news for 2024. We're finally showing a positive variance, and after 3 years of negative results, this improvement reflects the hard work and strategic adjustments made by the administration through efficiencies and revenue enhancements. The $1.3 million in positive surplus that we're going to be identifying in the mid-year budget review projecting does come with some increased expenses. We've talked about the increased expense for Shrek. We've talked about the annexation increased expense based on their levy lid lift. But they come with efficiencies as well and revenue enhancements. Nevertheless, the net change, net positive change demonstrates discipline and effectiveness of new approaches in addressing past challenges. As we move forward, the positive variance provides a solid foundation for continued growth in our reserve balance and further closing that structural gap, because that's ultimately what we're trying to get to. So as a reminder, I mean, this is just a refresher looking back from 2021 to 2024, where we're at from 2023 to 2024 in just a year's time. We've moved from an 8.9 increase in expense needed in the mid-year budget to a positive surplus of 1.3 million. And that is including with some of those increased expenses. So I just want to say that that's a testament to, you know, the cabinet members, just as Eric was talking earlier. I mean, this is a collaborative effort that the cabinet members, as well as the recommendation from administration and council, are creating. That is showing fiscal responsibility, and I want to applaud that for everybody. Any questions on anything from there? All right. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay. Next up, Ariel Anderson.
Oh,
perfect. All right. And this is on Haifumi? Great.
Good morning. I'm Heather Page. And basically, we're just bringing forward the SBO that funds the roughly $2.5 million project loan for Haifumi Inn. This is our affordable housing. We have 14 units in it that are held for affordable housing for up to 40 years. They will serve seniors earning 60% or less over the course of that time period. Questions? I know we briefed this April 22nd, so.
Any questions from anyone up here? Councilor Beagle?
What's the total number of new units we're getting out of this?
Okay, so affordable housing is measured a little bit differently. If you want to look at the net, we're getting roughly, I think, like 46 new units, but it's an 88 unit because we have to demolish one piece of that to construct the full 88 units.
And so then this $2.5 million here, is that just to fund those 14 units?
So the way that we have to work it is we attach, so our 2.5 million, while it's a very generous contribution to the project, if you look at the other funders in it, we're like right around third. So we don't get to claim the whole project for affordability. We only get to claim basically what we do on a pro rata share. So we're looking at what's the percentage of funding that we're putting into the project, what would be the percentage of units that we would be pulling out of the project that we can attach our funding to. And so that's typically how we do it. In most affordable housing, we try to limit that to about 11 units, because if you exceed 11 units, sometimes it triggers some federal regulations that make it more expensive for developers. In this particular case, because it was local funds, we were able to increase that above that 11.
And so what's the total amount that our 2.58 ended up helping to fund?
It's that 14 units. Okay. Yep.
Okay. How does the loan aspect work?
So the loan aspect, It's the 1% over the 40 years, and it's deferred. And so what we ask is of all of our developers, if they can afford a certain amount of debt service, we would like to see them propose those terms. In the case of this particular project, a grant was very, very complicated in that we would have had to actually grant it to a different organization that then loaned it to the Haifumi M project. That's just the low-income housing tax credit situation. So that's what it is. It's 1% over 40 years deferred.
Okay. All right. Any other questions?
And the 1% that's deferred, when is it? I mean, how long is it deferred? Is it deferred for the 40 years?
It is.
Okay.
For the 40.
Is it one of the things where it's deferred and then sort of forgiven if they complete that 40-year process? Is that what it is?
Not in this document, no, because this particular project couldn't have a forgivable loan. Mm-hmm. Now, we often see these projects at the end of their affordability period or even at the point where the projected inflation of costs exceeds the projected inflation of income, applying for different types of refinancing. At that point in time, then that's when that deferred payment would probably, yeah.
I will say that if my math is right, it looks like each unit's around 180,000, which is actually probably better than we often get. So
yeah,
that's good. Yeah. Okay, anything else? Nope, all right.
Okay.
Thank you so very much. Number six, our last item here, Colin Quinhurst, SBO on FTA pilot program.
Good morning. This is a special budget ordinance for the FTA TOD pilot program to accept award funds from a grant for the Division Street TOD plan. As you recall, we applied for this way back in summer of 2021. We were awarded $405,000 in fall of 2021. We went through an extensive process to set up an interlocal agreement with STA, Spokane County, and ourselves to do a joint planning effort on Division Street. And the purpose of this grant is to integrate land use and transportation investments, recognizing that STA is making a core capacity transit improvement on Division. We want to do our share on the land use side to make the most of it. And so this grant will be used to hire a consultant, and we'll study 3 to 4 nodes within City of Spokane, 1 to 2 in Spokane County, and look at ways to make the most of the BRT corridor. So what we did is we signed the interlocal agreement last fall, and we went through an RFQ process this year, so January to May, to select a consultant. We've selected the consultant now, so we're doing this SBO to accept the grant funds so that we can pay them. And so we'd be bringing the consultant contract to you next Monday at Urban Experience, and both this SBO and the consultant contract would go to full city council on June 24th. So those would go to council the same day.
So what is the amount of the dollars that we're getting, and then what do we think for the city share the full cost of the planning is gonna be? Do we think it's gonna be completely paid for?
We do have a cash match. It's $5,000 per year.
Okay.
So feel like that's a pretty good return there. Total cost would be then $415,000, so $5,000 per year, $10,000 total cash from the city.
And we think that's adequate for what we're trying to accomplish?
We are estimating $86,000 in staff time. So there is quite a bit of staff time going into managing this thing and working on it.
Okay. Do we know where those nodes are at this point?
Not yet. We have some of them are, you know, rising to the top, but we haven't finalized the selection, and we'd want some community involvement in finalizing those selections.
Well, hopefully the North Town area would be one of those nodes. So
that's what I was thinking of. Yeah.
Other questions, comments, thoughts from anybody? Hearing, seeing none. Okay. Well, we don't have anything left on our agenda. Councilor.
I do want to ask on the Westlaw here contract, if we've got a minute.
Chris, can you speak to that?
Yeah, this is an annual renewal of the legal department's Westlaw contract. The only thing that's, I think prices have gone up mm-hmm. on that, but it obviously is an essential tool for the legal department. The only thing that's perhaps novel this year is that they'll be giving an extra license to the city council.
So that was just the thing I wanted to make sure was in there, because we talked about getting access for you to Westlaw. And so is that in this?
It is.
It will be, yes.
Okay. That's my question.
Yep. No, it's a good deal.
What about updates from staff, our staff?
Oh, you are. Yeah, yes. Okay.
Is it Jacoby?
Yeah, I can start. Some of the things I've been working on, of course, hiring that new budget director position. I've been staffing a couple of boards and work groups across various topics, including collaborating with our CA members on kind of updating our processes around responding to neighborhood councils. Chris and I are still in the process of you know, finalizing our draft for you all to formally approve in some way, shape, or form that would kind of set out expectations and timelines for council's response to neighborhoods and other city-related groups. I've been working with the finance team on our internal council office budget and implementing our legislative assistant two positions that have been codified in the code, and working on looking at other central staffs like Tacoma, Boise, Salt Lake City, Santa Fe, and seeing just kind of how they structure their offices and if there's anything we can learn from them. I'm also working on doing better at notifying council members when we have last minute items come up, including press conferences, special meetings, just making sure that we have a quick, transparent, OPMA compliant way to communicate with each other on a quick timeline that may end up just being kind of a blanket text that I'm going to send individually to council members, notifying you that something is going to be noticed in the next couple of minutes or something when we have those last minute things come up. Just looking into some other more operational things internally, updating our teams and our council office SharePoint and making sure that we have all of our templates kind of easily accessible to staff, both internally and externally.
Okay, ARPA is next. And Alex, if you want to make your way, because we'll do equity after that.
ARPA is up for discussion later today. I feel like that's been a confusing process.
It's been fun.
I don't know what else beyond that, I guess.
So we're obviously trying to figure out the last $5 million, and there's not a lot of agreement anywhere on this, and so we continue to work back and forth on different proposals to try and bring forward and, you know, trying to keep everybody in the loop as much as possible. But a lot of disagreement on the last $5 million.
I would say Council President's proposal right now is to move forward with some of the funding that there seems to be broader consensus on, and then rediscuss as a council on the remaining part at a study session, I think, is the proposal.
And thank you, Council Member. So I really like to move items forward that is some alignment, especially the courts. You know, they're under a timeline. Some of those other issues have a timeline to get those RFPs out as we continue to work on some of the smaller ones that we've got going on, and to work with our grants department as to, as much as we want them, can they actually be implemented or in place by the end of 2024? The last thing we want is for ARPA money to be returned to the federal government. So I think there'll be a little bit more compromise that we might have to come to get across the finish line.
I'll just say on that, I think there is while we're up against it, there is still time to implement the things that we're discussing. While it would be, you know, moving pretty quickly, there's absolutely still time.
Okay, so for those watching, if you want to have a fun afternoon, tune into our briefing session at 3:30, and you'll hear a lot of debate on amendments on ARPA. Alex, you want to give us a quick overview of equity and inclusion initiatives?
Yeah, good afternoon, or still good morning, Council. So I was out last week, but definitely tomorrow we have the Equity Subcommittee meeting. We're still working through appointing some members, additional members to that subcommittee. We're working on some bylaw changes there as well. I've also been working on how do we beef up some belonging and anti-racism, like, conversations, either through policy and or defining it better. So we're presenting that at the Equity Subcommittee, and that's also been part of another working group. We're also doing community days. I can speak to one that we're doing June 24th, Refugee and Immigrants Day. That's usually celebrated June 20th, but we don't have a council meeting on the 19th. And then also this afternoon, I don't know if Zach, you want to give this update or if you want me to. So this afternoon, we're also having a Pride Community Day starting at 5, reading the proclamation down here at Chase Gallery and then raising the Pride flag. So inviting community members who wanted to be a part of that. And also inviting the broader community to come and be a part of that as well. I think the community days has been something that's happened more organically with community members that want to invite others that haven't been to council meetings before, and they're volunteering their times to come and table and share some of the resources here at council, and sometimes sharing their cultural heritage during our council meetings. So, you know, just trying to facilitate some of those conversations.
Okay. And Alex, while you're there, any updates on language access? I think it's been a little over a month since we met last, and so don't know if there's any updates.
Yeah, no, I think last time we met, we have our working group that met with Jarrell and Sarah Nuss as well to kind of see kind of where they're at. It sounds like the there's a staff person that's being appointed, and I think this is Jarrell's update, but there's a staff person that's been appointed to be the designated language access coordinator to help do that, and then also IT was hiring somebody to also start building in the technological infrastructure for that.
And if I remember correctly, Jarrell thought that there was a good chance we could have some stuff implemented between August and October, I think is kind of what his goal was, right?
Yeah, his timeline was sometime this year.
Yeah.
And be able to use a lot of the funding that was allocated through ARPA.
Perfect. Okay. Moving on to Ledge Committee. Is there anything beyond the Fed update that we got today? No? Okay. Investment Committee, have not met. Spokane Employee Retirement System.
About a month ago, Christine Schisler and I went down to Phoenix for an investment conference with the Highest Group. It was their first annual. The Highest Group is the one who manages our investments and brings it forward to the board. So that was a successful trip for us. We got to interact with a lot of other investment professionals, so that was good. Beyond that, we obviously just appointed Bo to our board, and there may be maybe more to come. So.
Aging long-term care.
Aging long-term care, we are in the process of moving from our location to the new Rock Point building, hopefully be in there by October, expansion of services, and another contract with DSHS to provide more in-home service care for our seniors. So I think we really need to elevate what's going on with our elderly population, and they've kind of taken the lead on that. Relocation.
Okay. AWC.
Annual conference coming up June 18th, 19th, and 20th in Vancouver. Glad to say we're taking several of our council members and some of our initiative managers. It'll be the first time the city of Spokane has really participated. It's a great conference. It's educational. It's networking. So I'm excited to have a team there with me this year.
And we'll be sure to report back what we learned next month.
Report back, yes.
And we got fire, police, pension. No updates that I can recall.
None.
Anything? Okay. Lodging tax, both committees and the board.
I'll start with the tourism and cultural investment committee. The application went live and the press release went live last Friday. So it is out. People are encouraged to apply and trying to get funds out the door. The committee is going to meet next week to talk about a prioritization of applications before they come back so that we know a rubric to grade or score, and then meet in July to score those applications and hopefully get those funded as soon as possible.
For the PFT, the Big L TAC, there was some funds left over from 2023 that we were making available to the Sports Commission, Visit Spokane, and the podium, if they can use that money by the end of this year to enhance their programs going forward. And then in September, we'll be looking at new proposals for next year of how those organizations are funded. So more to come. I am excited they're going to do a unified campaign around In Spokane We All Belong. just to address some of the issues that we're experiencing around hate crimes, perceived hate crimes, the perception that we're not a welcoming community, and to really not have that, or to mitigate the impact of what's happening around sports in our community, especially around what happened with the Gonzaga team, because really we only have one more year left on the NCAA contract, which is next year. And so how are we really promoting that Spokane is the place to be to continue to hold those tournaments in our area?
Okay. I just hope we don't lose them. All right, UDPDA, University District.
We have a retreat tomorrow, so okay. More to come next month.
More to come. And Visit Spokane, anything else there?
Business just really been busy with promoting expo celebrations and stuff like that, so I don't think anything more specific than that.
Okay. And then West Plains PDA.
We are in the process of hiring a new person. We have not had a meeting in the last month, so just continue partnerships about the growth that's going on out there between them and the airport and Airway Heights and the city. So exciting stuff to come.
Awesome. And then we got NEPDA, and there really isn't anything new since our last finance committee, but just excited. We are soon to have an official, albeit temporary, office, which is great. An intern and another staff member, hopefully in the next couple of months. And then we did just pick our owner's rep to start working through the state process of getting the development done there at Haven and Wellesley. So really exciting stuff. Looking forward to seeing that come to fruition. Yep.
One last comment on our consent agenda here, as well as the outside council contract amendment that would increase the amendments for Keating, Buckland, and McCormick by $100,000 for a total of $250,000 in the Bradley case there. And I think that number is significant for a reason that we'll be voting on tonight. So just wanted to bring that to everybody's attention.
Okay. Appreciate that. Anything else for the good of the order? Hearing, seeing none. All right. We're adjourned. Thanks, everybody.